God using this group to do it.
Father God, in Jesus' name, I thank you for the privilege of standing before your people to proclaim the glorious, miraculous, creative, wonderful word. So, Father, I pray, put your heart in my mouth this day, Lord God. Minister to your people. Touch their hearts. Heal their bodies. Restore their minds, Lord God. It's not this message put into here, but touch your people, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We've been teaching on the heart of the matter the last 7 weeks, so I didn't think I'd be going this long. You know, walking with God is an adventure. It really is an adventure. If somebody heard a word about, you might want to pick that little reader about my kid. The word I think Joe had about not being boring to serving God, it's always exciting. If you notice under your chairs, there's a bunch of kneelers under there. This week, and it's still a reaper's in there, take that out of there. This week I was buying one of our apartments and someone had a sofa out there. And I said, are you throwing that sofa out? He said, yeah. Threw it in the truck. Thought I'd bring it to the secondhand place, and I did. And I was at the secondhand place, and you know, I got to watch my hearing. Because the lady, I said, how much do you want for that? And Jimmy said, she heard the lady say $250. But I heard, somehow she said, I'll give you half, $125. And I thought she said $125. So I said, give me $60, man. I was ripping myself off of that. I was always in $60. But what happened was, I saw all these kneelers. I said, what is that? So said, oh, these are kneelers from a church. And I said, I tell you what, I'll trade you the sofa for the kneelers. So we got a whole truckload of kneelers. Glory to God, so we can kneel in church. So let those kneelers out. Just take that out and run. So we got a whole truckload of kneelers. Praise God. Didn't cost a dime. But the point is, I was in the right place at the right time. Amen. You just can't make things like that happen. Only man with the Holy Ghost is excited about kneelers, okay? Glory to God. But it happens all the time. When you're walking with God, you never know. We were in a Home Depot. I was with Jimmy. We were walking in there, and I saw a brother. He was a preacher that had fallen in sin. He had backslide somewhat, but he had come back to God, and he wasn't really where he needed to be. And while we were in Home Depot, I remember just closing my eyes, laying hands on the word of the Lord came upon us. We began prophesying upon him right there about restoration to call, restoration to the things of God. Right there in the Home Depot, right in the main aisle. Praise God. Just remember, you can do that anywhere. Just close your eyes, nobody sees you. That's the way it works. Okay? It's the normal to prophesy in the Wendy's. I've had God tell me before, head to Metairie. Where are we going, God? He said, Wendy's. Praise God, it's lunchtime. And he had me go over there and give a word to somebody. Or send me just out of the way places because he cares about souls, he cares about people. It's an adventure with God as you walk with God. You never know. The Spirit of God is going to lead you and guide you. Amen. But talking about our heart, God wants to get to our heart. There's two more areas of our heart I'm going to talk about today that I didn't get to talk about. You might want to reset that for me, Nick. So I was talking, I think the computer might have froze up on me. Thank God for technology that we had trouble with. There you go. Put it back. But your heart's going to affect everybody in your house. Now, you see a bunch of hands there. You got your church, your friends, your mom, your dad, no one's job. If you've got a bitter heart, if you've got an angry heart, you can't just be, you know, it's going to affect your kids. It's going to affect the way you relate to your wife and your husband. Everyone that knows you at work, it'll be you. You have a value. Would to God you value people like that. Would to God you value people like that money I'm throwing at you. You wouldn't throw people away. You didn't know if it was 100, a 50, or a 1. You don't know. But what I'm trying to tell you is if you value people, you would never throw them away. You surround them. I mean, it's Mardi Gras time. Listen, we don't go to parades. We don't do all that. But I see people fight with the balloons. It's trinkets. Yes. Years ago, I dove into a pile of guys fighting and punching to come out with a plastic hand. Get out with a plastic hand. I said, this is stupid. I'm getting all beat up for a plastic hand. So yeah, I threw the money at you. Now, listen, if somebody's throwing money at me, you're my new best friend, okay? But I did that to prove a point. That you value that not knowing what it is. So you say, oh, I'm going to take it. I'll clean it off. I saw Pastor Joe put dirt on it, but I don't mind. I'll clean it off. I'll do something with it. When you truly love people and you value them, you will never throw them away. You'll never throw them away. Never. Amen? You'll never throw them away. That's what I wanted to show you about. We throw people away so easy when Jesus died for them. Now, we want to be careful we don't get the cutoff ministry or the shout ministry. That's when you throw people away. A person who's easily offended will eventually become bitter and begin cutting people out of their lives, even God-given relationships. Oh yeah, I often tell a story of someone who was here. They told me about, I'm offended with my mama, I'm offended with this one, and I don't talk to my mom no more. I'm sitting there listening to them. I'm thinking, well, my turn's about to come pretty soon. I was actually thinking that. My turn is coming, man. Everything he's telling me. Well, it wasn't long, and I tell the story, and you know, God did a miracle in his life. God grew his leg, and I tell the story. He got offended with me, and then, gone. You don't want to be that way, because that was a divine relationship that just threw away. This is what Jesus said. If you think this doesn't happen with God, I want to show you this. People throw Jesus away. They did it before, and they'll do it again. John 6:56, Jesus said this to the Jewish people, "He who feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood dwells continually in me, and I in like manner dwell continually in him." Now, when the disciples heard this, this is verse 60, many of them said, "This is a hard and difficult, strange saying, an offensive and unbearable message. Who can stand to hear it? Who can be expected to listen to such teachings?" They're like, "Man, I can't hear it. I can't bear this," is what they said. And look what it said. Jesus, knowing within him that his disciples were complaining and protesting and grumbling about it, and he didn't explain himself. He wasn't saying, I'm speaking metaphorically, by the way. Said to them, "Is it a stumbling block and an offense to you? Does this upset and displease and shock and scandalize you?" And after this, look at this, many of the disciples drew back, returned to their old associations, and no longer accompanied him over an offense. You know what's going to help you? If you have a revelation, if your revelation that you're called to be here, a revelation of what your assignment is, you looked at Peter and said, "You also are going to go away." And Peter said, "Who now shall I go? You have the words of eternal life." He had a revelation of the calling of God upon his life and who he was assigned to. When you got that, when the offense comes, you're like, "Look, I'm not moved by this offense. I'm going to overcome this offense." Because I said, when the offense comes. Not if, when. The devil will make sure it comes. Now with that, almost got it. I've got something else I'm saying. A good example of a hardness and a bitter heart that devalues people and cuts people off is a woman caught in adultery. Now, John 8:3 says this, "The scribes and Pharisees brought to him a woman taken in adultery, and when they said unto them this, they say unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act." We caught her with the guy, basically. "Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned, but what do you say?" So they dragged this woman out into the square up to Jesus. And they said, tempting him that they might accuse him, but Jesus stooped down and with his finger he wrote on the ground, and as though he heard them not. He didn't respond, just being right on the ground, right in the dirt. "And when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at him." So if you have sin, throw your first stone. So what they did? He says, "When they heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, they went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst." You know why the eldest unto the last? Because the longer you've been alive, the more you know you've got issues. That's why they began dropping the stones first. And what did he do? "When Jesus had lifted himself up, he saw none but the woman. And he said to her, Woman, where is these thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? And she said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more." I want you to see this.
Come on, you sinner. You dirty sinner. Get on the ground.
Yeah, sinner! Yeah!
Adultery. You're caught in the act of adultery. We're about to stone you. Y'all got y'all stones? Yeah. Y'all got y'all stones?
Yeah. We're stoning you! Yeah.
Alright. Alright, Rabbi, we're about to stone him. What do you say?
He without sin may cast the first stone.
But the law says we need a stoner.
I
didn't know all that.
Anyone ever condemned you?
No.
Neither do I. And I go and sin no more.
You don't throw stones anymore. You just speak down. You're talking about it. And get self-righteous. It's one of the worst sins ever. I can't believe that person. I can't believe what they did. Especially if you've been in Christ for a while, maybe you're not doing what you used to do. You can get self-righteous. And we don't throw stones when we talk about people. Or your preachers that fall, or someone that falls, and instead of being there to love on them and help them and bless them, man, we throw our words at them. That's what we do. Come on, God. When we judge them, some of y'all out there, yeah, stone. I haven't seen a stone in a while. I call it getting invited to a rock concert. And you're the star. You're the star. Now, did you know the Hebrew word for rebel? This is so important. It's mar. That's where we get our word marah from. Okay? It means a chaos man. Okay? Chaos man. It's where we get the word marah for bitter. So a person who is bitter becomes a chaos person. Chaos. Rebel. Word rebel and bitter are interchangeable in the Hebrew. So it means you're a person that creates chaos. So from a bitter heart, an unforgiving heart, if you don't deal with it, you have a bitter heart, And you're going to create chaos in your life and the lives of other people. Hebrews tells us this, Hebrews 12:15. Exercise foresight and be on watch to look after one another, to see that no one falls back and fails to secure God's grace. So is it possible that you can fail to secure God's grace over what? An offense. Absolutely. It happens all the time. The devil's good at bringing it. His unmerited favor and spiritual blessing, in order that no root of resentment, rancor, bitterness, or hatred shoots forth and causes trouble and bitter torment. That's why we got to walk in the love of God. I've seen that the love of man will turn the hatred overnight. Oh, I love you. And when you don't perform the way they expect, it turns to hatred or goes to the divorce court. That's why we got to operate in the love of God, the agape love of God in our life. Remember, love's not lying. It sees and still loves. That's pretty simple, right? So in order that no root of resentment, rancor, bitterness, or hatred shoots forth and causes trouble and bitter torment, and the many become contaminated and defiled by it. So chaos and bitterness go hand in hand. I'm almost done, guys. This is a picture of the Dead Sea. Now, its bitter waters are so potent that this much in a glass will actually sink to the hospital and even kill you. You can't drink the waters. So you become a bitter person. If anybody drinks of the waters of your life, you spread that bitterness and you kill people's spirit. Or if I would be bitter, I'd be killing people's spirit. The things you say, the things that we do, it comes out of our own heart, out of the well that has been contaminated with bitterness in our heart. And this place in the Red Sea, in the Dead Sea, is the lowest place on earth. You know, bitterness is about the lowest you can go. It's the worst sin in other sins. It really is. It's a terrible sin to be bitter and unforgiving before God. Especially how much He's forgiven us. He's forgiven us of so much. Now, here's the good news. When the Lord returns, the Dead Sea is going to live again. The Bible says that the living waters are going to flow into it again. And the good news for us is this, is when we return back to God and say, God, I've been bitter. God, I've been unforgiving. God, I forgive them. I release them as an act of my will. God, I'm just going to forgive them. I ask you, I pray for them, God. I bless them, Lord God. Don't bless them like this. Lord, let their teeth fall out. Bless them on the brink. You know, that's the imprecatory prayers of Psalms. Don't pray like that. Pray blessings upon them. That's what the Bible says, to pray blessings upon them. And the more you pray, the less your heart's going to be bitter. And life's going to flow back into you again. Life's going to flow back into you. Just like the Dead Sea was going to come alive again, you'll come alive again. You'll have joy again. You'll have peace again. And your heart will be restored again. Because bitterness, the Dead Sea, it takes in and never pours out. It's just a big Dead Sea. We don't want to be like the Dead Sea. We don't want to be bitter. Now, this is also amazing. The Hebrew word Shem means the name. The name always is a direct reference to God. The Hebrew word picture means destroys chaos, or the name of the Lord destroys chaos. There's one name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. If you're dealing with bitterness in your life, you're dealing with unforgiveness, maybe something happened to you a long time ago and you're still dealing with it, call on the name of the Lord. Begin to call on the name of the Lord and say, God, I need help. God, I forgive, Lord God, help me, Lord. Heal my heart, restore my heart. And He'll destroy the chaos in your life. Just like you read in Genesis, and God said, and God said, and then God said, and He brought order out of the chaos. God's Word and God's Spirit will put order in your life out of the chaos that bitterness brings in our life and unforgiveness. There's still power in the name of Jesus. Amen? Oh, glory to God. I want to show you this. I'm almost done. In the ministry of Moses, the Lord showed us a picture of returning to Jesus to be healed of a bitter and unforgiving heart. So what happened was, Moses had taken the people into the wilderness 3 days. Okay, now just imagine if I'm Moses and I'm taking y'all out into the wilderness for 3 days. Y'all haven't drank any water. Some of y'all are going to be complaining, where is Pastor Joe Leaders? I can't believe it. Y'all might even have stones all lined up for me. I don't know. That's what happened. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea, they had billions of them though. And they went out into the wilderness of Shur. That's what young people say all the time. You want to go to the wilderness? Sure. Right? And they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. 3 days without drinking, y'all not going to be happy with me. And when they came to Marah, bitterness, they could not drink the water. So 3 days, you haven't drank water. Y'all about to go to a restaurant. You're going to complain if they're too long bringing you your refill. So after 3 days, you're thirsty. And I said, the Lord is leading me, my brethren. And I bring y'all to a big, big body of water. But you can't drink it because it's bitter. Now you're really bitter. Okay? Speaks of bitterness in our heart. Okay, things that we go through that we get bitter. So when it came to Marah, bitterness, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore, the name of it was called Marah, or bitter. Man, I came to a bitter place in my life. Are you in a bitter place in your life? Have you come to a bitter place? Bitter place in your marriage? Bitter place at work? bitter place in your relationships. It's just, man, God, I've been through so much, and I finally get here now. This is so hard, God. You're bitter, you're angry about it. And that's exactly what happened to them. Here's the answer. The people murmured against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" So it's going to happen. You come to that bitter place, you start complaining, crying out. And he cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree, which when he had cast into the waters were made sweet. And there he made for them a statute and an ordinance, and there he proved them. It's the cross of Christ. Coming back to the cross of Christ. Coming back to your first love. When Jesus died, you knew he died for your sins, and you don't have any stones in your hand to throw at anybody else. You say, "Jesus, I remember how much of a sinner I was and all the things I did wrong." And when you come back to the cross of Christ, when you apply that to your hearts, the bitterness goes. It goes from your life. Amen? It's that simple. It's coming back to your first love and coming back to the cross. What's up, pray with me right now? Now, I've been talking about bitterness. We're talking about conditions of the heart. But the first thing is this. If you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, you come to church, mom and dad brought you to church, you've never, ever given him to Christ, pray this with me now. Jesus, be the Lord of my life. I confess you as my Lord and Savior. I believe you died for me. I believe you were buried. And I believe you rose again the third day. And I thank you, according to your word, that I'm saved in Jesus' name. The next thing I want to do is I want to pray with you. If you have a bitter heart, despite your husband right now, if you have a bitter heart, double heart, right now, ask God to heal your heart. Forgive the person that you're offended with. Forgive them. Release them. Let them go. Say, "God, I forgive them in Jesus' name." And you might have all the feelings of anger and everything else rise up within you. And I'm going to give you an assignment. Here's your assignment to overcome this. Is every day you pray for that person. Every single day, pray for that person. Lift them up before God. Ask God's blessing. And when the devil brings back, "Oh, look what they did," you got to say, "Thank you, Mr. Devil, for reminding me to pray for them. Had you not reminded me to pray for them, I would have forgotten all about it." And pray blessings on them. And if he reminds you again, you say, "You know what, Mr. Devil? Thank you for reminding me. Thank you for reminding me again. Now I'm going to pray double blessings because you reminded me twice." And if he reminds you again, say, "Thank you, Mr. Devil, for reminding me again. Now I'm going to pray three times the blessings on him because you reminded me again." What's going to happen is your offense is going to go out of your life. And you're going to have love, whether it was hatred. Whether it was bitterness, it's going to be sweetness once again. I'm prophesying to you, I'm telling you. If you'll do this, it'll work in your life. This is how you overcome. This is how you overcome it. Amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Father, we give you praise. We thank you for your word, Lord God. Father, we thank you to everybody that did what they did today to demonstrate, Lord God, forgiveness, Lord God, and mercy, Lord God. Father, in the name of Jesus, I want you to stand up with me right now. I want to pray a blessing upon you right now. Hallelujah. Come on, Trisha, come up here real quick. Restoration. Hallelujah. Father God, we just pray for the flock of God. Heavenly Father, I pray restoration upon your people, Lord God. Restore their hearts. Whatever the condition of their heart is right now, God, restore it to yourself, Lord God. Restore the fire. Restore the joy. Restore the peace, Lord God. Restore broken relationships, Lord God. Let us not be your people that throw anyone away. You don't throw anybody away. You said, "I would in no wise cast you out." So, Father, we come to you. Fill us with your love. Fill us with your grace. Fill us with your mercy. And, Father, we bless your people. Let them be a blessing and go forth whole in every way, Father, we pray in the name of Jesus. Restored in every facet of their life and relationships, Lord God, and especially with you, Lord God. Father, we ask this. In Jesus' mighty name, we decree this blessing on your people. Amen.